how to encapsulate the incredible situation that's taking place. Let's start out this way. It's in a grocery store. Very depressed. It's almost too much right now. And I hear this song. And on the way back home, I promise you'll never be alone. I say, hey, wait a minute. On the way back home, I promise you'll never be alone. I said, that. Reminiscing Little River Band. And then they're playing this song, and it's just like, wow, it just floored me. It's exactly what I needed to hear. I mean, that song was very, very prophetic, a spiritual song. The music in the 60s, 70s, and even 80s was really quite something. Hurry, don't be late. Hurry, don't be late. Also, hurry, don't be late. I can hardly wait, I said to myself. And hurry, don't be late. And it hit me. Hurry, don't be late. And why did this hit me? Listen to this. This is what floored me today. I've spoken many times about this prophetic dream that I had about this massive collapse of this wall, rock wall, huge wall, collapsing and disintegrating into boulders that rolled everywhere and buried this highway and created dust everywhere, terrible dust. And I escaped it in this white vehicle going very fast. First of all, we were just given a white vehicle, just gifted a brand new white vehicle. Second of all, the highway number, I'm absolutely positive this because I know the mountain San Jacinto, and where it collapsed is along Highway 111. 111, 111, Highway 111 through Palm Springs, Cathedral City, Palm Desert, Rancho Mirage, Indian Wells, all the way out to India. So this was the highway that was buried, 111. I'm wondering, what in the world does that mean exactly? Well, guess what? I was reading today. I should have double-checked it, but it's right there in black and white. The World Series. Now, what's something that I would know about the World Series? Absolutely, I would know about that. I'd get my attention. I know when it is. It's October. Actually, starts October 27th this year. Guess what? This is the 111th World Series. When I saw that, it just floored me. Because that is something that the dream, if wanted to get my attention, this is something we'd use baseball. 111th World Series. This is when the collapse, it's saying the collapse is going to take place. It seems to indicate this. Also, the Pope, Malachi's prophecy, St. Malachi's prophecy of the Pope, the Pope prophesies 112. Now, we think that this Pope is the 112th. Pope Francis, maybe, but Catholic historians say that John Paul I and John Paul II, they lump them into one, so that'd be the 109th. Pope Benedict would be the 110th. Pope Francis, you got it, 111th. 111th Pope. Since Malachi's prophecies, naming every pope, and the 112th would be the one where the destruction of the Catholic Church and the massive, massive tribulation would take place. 111th World Series, 111th Pope and the prophecies. Highway 111 is where this collapse took place. No doubt about it. So this just like, wow. Now, here's another thing. I'm asking people who's going to win the World Series. For me, I say it's Kansas City against the Cubs. But the Cubs could win. It's possible. Yeah, I think they'll get in and they have a chance. But everybody asks, they say, who's going to win? They say, like, the Cubs. And I say, why? And they say, back to the future. It's back to the future time. Back to the future time. Because in the movie Back to the Future, and Marty McFly travels at 2:15, and he sees a headline that says Chicago Cubs win the World Series 2:15. Right. This, and I ask people, I said, whoa, if that happens, what do you think? And they say, wow, that would be, and everyone shakes their heads, whoa, you know, there's something going on here. The Cubs haven't won in 106 years, I believe, something like that. 106 years, they never won the World Series. It was what, 1908 or something, last time they won, something like that. This is getting strange. And the World Series starts October 27th and goes into November. 27, 28, day off. 29, 30, 31, day off. November 2nd and 3rd. So it should November 2nd and 3rd. The new The Economist magazine, the picture on the front of the Economist has these arrows, with dates on the lower right saying November 5th and then November 3rd. October 24th is the 70th anniversary of the United Nations. A lot of people are predicting some troubles in the end of October here. It's the world. I'm feeling the world is becoming surreal, and I want to give a tip to everybody here. Is just say, hey, I'll explain it all when hindsight kicks in. This opens up the door. Okay, you don't have to detail it, explain it. How'd you get here and blah blah. Just say, you know, as soon as hindsight kicks in, I'll explain it. I'll explain it to you. How about that for a great dodge, a great sidestepping? Yeah, sure. As soon as hindsight, you know everything calms down and hindsight is 20/20, then I'll be able to explain it. Right now, hindsight hasn't kicked in yet, and I can't, it's not something I can force, so I just, you know, when it happens, it happens. I'll let you know. I'll let you know. Meanwhile, I'm enlightened. Okay. Everything feels very surreal now. That dream I have, the terrible storm coming, I was given this table to hide under. Black and white. The car is black and white. Gifted a vehicle. Black and white. You know, it's like, wow. The UN climate resolution that is resolution number 44. Resolution number 44 slash 230, what, 7? But 40, they in 1972, was it, or something? Or 78, maybe? This was the United Nations General Assembly took up this climate change issue, the environment, but climate change in particular. And it was called Resolution 44. This is how it's referenced in the COP21, which is the Conference of Parties, 21st Conference of Parties in Paris. This is the big one, and they have a D declaration dash 44. 44 is the number of this president, isn't it? It's also the number I've gotten in dreams, too. And it's a very important number. This Paris conference is it. I mean, there have been 20 others, okay, since 1990, starting 1995. Which has taken up climate change, which in the Rio 92, 189 back then countries or something, it was all the countries in the world, pretty much so, got on board and signed it. And then they started this conferencing of trying to come reach a mark that everyone agreed upon as far as heating, global warming, and then get legally binding agreement so that there's actual, that every national governance can begin pursuing that, reaching that mark. And so all the conferences up to this time have been working out, trying to work out the details, get a consensus and all this. Now the vote has to be unanimous, okay? Conference of Parties means, it's a business term, meaning the stockholders. And they view all the nations of the world as stockholders in this agreement of climate change. Global warming, okay? So all these stockholders are going to meet in Paris. How many people they feel they're going to attend? 40,000. I wouldn't be surprised if it's 44,000. and this is the biggest conference that France has ever hosted, the biggest deal. This is the biggest, as I said, this is the game changer, because what they're doing now in Bonn, starting, what is it, the 19th, Germany, is finalizing, getting, finalizing of what they're going to agree upon in Paris. Paris is just a dog and pony show for the world. All these delegates are going to come, and they're going to show a strength. They take all the pictures, the conferences, everything. But what they're really doing in Bonn this October is agreeing upon, is it going to be an increase in 2 degrees centigrade or 1.5, something like that, that by what, I'm not sure what date, you know, they're going to reduce, not going to increase by more than that by, I don't know what, 2050 or whatever it is. And the law, this whole thing takes effect in 2020. It takes full effect in 2020. But you can bet that the governance of every country in the world, they're going to be measuring the progress towards this. So they want a legally binding agreement, and this is what they believe they're going to get. This is what they believe they're going to get, and we're going to find out pretty soon if they've got it. It has to be unanimous. Or they can talk about some sort of consensual situation. But as far as voting on it, if it's not voted unanimously, then there's another protocol that they will use. But they're looking for unanimous. What it means is that all of the governments of the world, and the heads of state and the governments, they will claim a legal authority over their citizens and the businesses and the sovereignty of their nation. They will claim a legal authority up from this climate change declaration to impose all these new standards upon the citizens and all the businesses of their country. This is what it means. And I was looking up this futurist think tank in England or something who's looking into this, and they say there is going to be severe shock in the world when this takes place. This is what they're forecasting. This is what I've been saying. This is what the Holy Spirit's trying to get through to us. There's going to be severe shock and biggest change in history. Nothing even comes close. It's coming up. I said 2:15 is when it all would happen, and indeed, this is what's taking place now. What is that collapse of the wall in the dream? I still don't know for sure. I still don't know for sure. We'll find out soon enough. Is it an economic collapse? Is it this? Is it this? Is it that? Well, they may want an economic collapse to slow down the carbon emissions, right? They may want a massive debt collapse. To just crush the whole economy of the world, to make it easier, and then from there make it easier to rebuild based on the Paris COP21 agreement. You see what could happen is they may say, you know, you talk about a doomsday cult. It's the ultimate doomsday cult. They're saying it's already too late. Planet's doomed, and we can't possibly reach, you know, slow it down fast enough. It's a fait accompli. We're toast. And then they use that to drive all their members, you know, to agree. We got to do this. It's a doomsday cult. It's the worst doomsday cult in history. Amazing. And of course they say, oh, it's all scientific. It's all backed up by facts. And of course we know how computer models always turn out. Just come on. It's based on computer models, and who knows what kind of tweaking they've been doing with those. Anyway, they're saying, yeah, I mean, if we don't stop it immediately, the world will become ungovernable, absolute chaos, and human race is toast, planet's toast, dead planet, finished. So this is what we're up against. This is what the planet is up against. So it wouldn't be, you know, past them at all to engineer a global economic collapse, which would grind everything to a halt, so to speak, produce famines, you know, basically lower the population down severely, and then at that point start rebuilding a new planet, a new age, a new infrastructure based on these very tight guidelines that they have. They've already said they can't meet them. This is what's already coming out, is they say, well, even if we agree, it's too late. So just reading between the lines, if this is their ideology and belief, it's already too late no matter what they do. Unless there is some sort of global collapse. Or a combination of events that severely reduces the world population, and at which point then they would again produce this new world order, this new age, with, you know, very much fewer people and all of them agreeing to extreme controls on everything. And they, you know, they'll take their chances with that. I don't know what else to make about the some of these top people saying it's already too late coming out. This is quite worrisome if this is what they really believe. They may take more drastic measures. This is the key number. There's no question. I'm trying to figure out 111. What's so key about that? Wow. 111th World Series, October of this year. There's so much convergence going on from all angles. Everywhere, look, there's convergence going on. As I said, the fall of this year is very, very crucial. We already know what... the Paris climate talks are in the fall. They're November 30th through the 11th of December. That's still the fall. Winter doesn't come until December 21st. So the fall of 2015 has been the something that has, I was told about 12 years ago, that 2015 is the key year. No question about it. And then more recently, I said the fall of this year is when it's going to, you're going to get the full picture, and I'm not the only one saying this. This is something that many people are feeling now. But what is the full picture? There's something we're missing. There's no question about it, and we just have to accept that, you know. And it may come just like an enlightenment, and then we'll say, well, we'll sort it all out in hindsight, but not now. We're missing something. So I would say the best advice now, along with this hindsight. In insight of, you don't have to explain things. Say, well, I'll explain everything once hindsight kicks in. Yeah, not now at all. Say, I don't have the hindsight yet. How can you expect me to explain without hindsight? Come on. That's ridiculous. It's too murky. But let the enlightenment kick in. So the other thing is to say, you know what? We're missing something. There's something we're missing. And I kind of got it today. I had it flashed on me what it is today. And I can't, you know, maybe let hindsight kick in on that too. There's some little thing I remember from my childhood what it is. It's kind of like Buddha remembering in his childhood that sitting by that rose bush or some kind of a bush and realizing what meditation really works. He said, oh, yeah, I remember that's what works. It was like that. And from right then, he had it, you know. Oh, I think he was doing this ascetic meditation. He was about ready to die from starvation. And suddenly, you remember when he was a child sitting by this shrub. He thought of this meditation, like, how about doing it, like, looking at it like this. And then suddenly said, that's it. No more asceticism. He is enlightened. It was like that. I said, wow, I remember something in my childhood. Yeah, is don't try when you're enlightened. Don't try and go back and say, "Oh, that was easy. That was so easy. Let me do it again." Don't do that. Okay, that was it. It was like, "Oh, that's so easy. How could it possibly be difficult? Let me go back and see again. It couldn't be difficult." Don't do that. Wait until hindsight kicks in. Okay, so when you're enlightened, you say, "I'm going to wait until hindsight kicks in before I make any decisions about whether I'm going to go back and do it again," because it seems so easy. It seems so easy. That you think, well, there's nothing to it. I mean, I couldn't possibly have difficulty. I need to go back and double check. That couldn't have been the difficulty. I mean, don't do it. Don't do it. Okay. That was the insight. We'll wait until hindsight kicks in. We're going to give it a nice long time period here for hindsight to see what hindsight reveals. We're not going to be in any hurry here. And we'll just... wait until we feel that the fullness of hindsight has truly, truly had its say in all of this. See, it's a trick. It's a trick. You get tricked to trick ourselves. This is what I remember when I was a child. I said, remember when you're older, that when you're enlightened, remember this. You know, don't try and go back and do it again. Wow. This Back to the Future thing too is really picking up steam. I just went and looked at some of this stuff about time travel, that movie, that trilogy, I guess, that really, really got into it very intensely. And people are just saying, you know, there's something going on right now. There's no doubt about it. And again, we're missing something. So just say, I'm missing some key component here, and let me just be aware of that and accept it and say, okay, I don't have the full picture here, so don't get upset or try to force it. There's just some, and it'll come. And on the way, well, Surf and Safari, again, that's another thing that popped into my head. If everybody had an ocean around the USA, everybody'd be surfing. Like California, you see them wearing their baggies, Hirachi sandals too, bushy blonde hairdo, surfing USA. You see them surfing at Del Mar, Ventura County Line, Santa Cruz and Trestles. That should be the. I see them surfing at Del Mar. Santa Cruz and Trestles, Australia's Narrow Bin, all over Manhattan and down Doheny Way, everybody's gone surfing USA. Well, I'll be planning on a route we're going to take real soon. We're waxing down our surfboards. We can't wait for June. We'll be gone for the summer. We're on safari to stay. Tell a teacher we're surfing USA. Haggerty's and Swami's, Pacific Palisades, San Onofre and Sunset, Redondo Beach, LA, all over La Jolla and Waimea Bay. Everybody's gone surfing USA. These songs are starting to, you know, resonate from the 60s and 70s. These songs are starting to resonate. And I say, wait a minute. Did we know the future back then? And I'd say, yes, we did. I knew I did. I knew the future back then. There's something going on with time right now. Oh, I know what it was. The day before yesterday, what was it? It was something very profound. I realized I'm going back to the 80s. We're shifting back into the 80s before the internet, before technology really took off. We're shifting back into the 80s somehow. There's really something profound with shift and time. And we're just going to have to, you know, let it click into place as it will. It is really coming on strong. Brenda Lee coming on strong. I can hear the feel the heartaches coming on strong. Yeah. In this world. 111. This is when the collapse took place. 111. That's probably what it was symbolizing. The third one. It'll become clear in hindsight. So we're missing something. Accept that and say, it's okay. I'm right there. I'm right with it. And I'm aware that there still has to be, you know, our awareness now opens to this. What are we missing? Maybe a song, something will catch your attention and say, wow. And on the way back home, I promise you, you'll never be alone. It's like the earlier decades. I'm feeling it now. I'm feeling the 60s. I'm feeling the 70s, the 80s. I'm feeling is something bleeding through, coming through somehow. I was driving around, and I just like, whoa, am I in the 60s? You know, or, whoa, am I back then? You know, just let it happen and say, I don't need to comment on it now. Whatever has happened, I don't need to comment. I have to wait till hindsight, you know, has it say. Because that's, to be fair, I have to wait, you know, for hindsight to have it say, really. And that, and you should say to other people, you know, adopt that philosophy. Instead of answering their questions, say, look, I've got something better for you. Adopt this philosophy for yourself. And I believe then, you know, you'll be able to share in, you know, what's going on. There's some sort of vibe right now that, you know, we can't really explain it. We'll have to let hindsight kick in before we explain it. But there is some vibe going on. Hit my weight goal yesterday. Still today. Fantastic. Continuing to try and, you know, undereat. I went out and got a whole bunch of frozen fruit today. So it means what? Smoothies. Going this weekend. Smoothies. Fruit smoothies. And some yogurt, Greek yogurt, and smoot fruities. I'm going to drink some smoot fruities. smoot fruities. Keep, you know, keep trending somehow. Keep trending. Whatever positive trends you have, keep trending that way. There's really something going on. October is the pregnant month. This month is extremely auspicious. And, oh, well, I just sort of getting this, this feeling like, hey, life, this life is, it was designed for surprises and twists and turns and, you know, this is how it's going to go. This is how it's going to go. It's already been that way, right? The last 60 years here in this world. Expect that to continue and be amplified, actually. You know, who knows what is next, right? I mean, it's just been one surprise after the other, actually, in this world. Most of them negative, actually, depending on how you look at it. But who's to say there isn't going to be some other big surprise coming up right now? And we just take it in stride. I mean, this is just how it is right now. We just take it in stride. You know? I mean, yeah. Oh, listen, a pack of coyotes graying out there. Wow. They're way in the suburbs here. That is crazy. They must be living in someone's backyard or something. There are a couple of areas here that have huge rambling sheds, backyards with all these sheds and everything. They probably live underneath the shed or something back there. Because this is like, other than that, it's just, you know, it's suburbs. There's no, there shouldn't be coyotes in the middle of the suburbs. This is really strange. So there is a vibe going on right now. And you just have to let it like a breeze. Let the breeze come in. And you just say, I don't have to explain anything right now. I'll just wait. I'm going to wait for hindsight to explain it. How about that as an insight? That is fabulous. Thanks to Holy Spirit to drop that right into my mind somehow. So this way, whatever you experience, you're not freaking out or struggling with it at all. You say, well, you know, yeah, I mean, I'm not going to even attempt to describe it or say anything about it. I'm just going to experience it right now. And then once hindsight fully, you know, has developed fully, then we'll see what kind of explanation or, you know, comments or whatever arise out of that hindsight. But right now I'm just going to stay in the moment and experience it. That's all. Sounds very 60-ish, you know. A lot more wisdom in the 60s. We weren't in so much of a rush. People are in a crazed rush right now. So you talk about like a, this is like not even a, it's like a practice. It's like a meta practice. I mean, it's what can you say about it? It's such an awesome idea. We're going to wait until hindsight fully develops before anything is said on this. Wow. It just takes us off the hook, doesn't it? It's off the hook. We're off the hook. That's a saying, of course. Off the hook means just, this is just like so amazing. You know, it's just, you can't even describe it. So awesome. Off the hook. It also means when you're in trouble, spot of trouble, you're hooked somewhere, you get off the hook. You're no longer subject or liable to all the trouble anymore. And on the way back home, I promise you, you'll never be alone. What a great song. Wow. Listen, I was listening to the song. I said, holy cow. I mean, the 1978. Tremendous recording technique and sound and engineering and overall quality of musicianship and everything. It's just spotlessly done in you know, on magnetic tape. Probably still using vacuum tubes on the mixing board and mics and amplifiers and everything, but it's just clean and crisp and resonant and smooth and whoa. So did we really do that in the 70s? Were we really that good? The answer is yes. There are some pretty cool cats back in the 60s and 70s, I'll tell you that. We've gotten our heads turned so severely right now. Back to the 80s. Before it all went sideways or cuckoo, you know, before we started going down this road, you know, and saying, and they said, well, this is the road you need to go down. But really, there was probably two roads to go down. And they did such a cool job, you know, or not, well, I shouldn't use that word, I just used it in different contexts, but they did just such a, they had such a, how would you call it, what the, this sort of arrogant assurance, confidence, the tech people, that now this is the road you go down. There's no question about it. You know, it's set in stone. Of course, they were faking it. I mean, they were all bluffing the whole thing originally. Yeah, they were just hoping they go down this road, hope to go down this road. But they act like this is a fait accompli. I mean, there's no doubt about it. We already know this is the road you go down, as if they're from the future and they're telling us this is the road you go down. Well, guess what? We're all from the future. So, now we're going back. And we're saying, oh, wait a minute. Let's go back to the 80s and let's think this over again. Was that really the only road that there was there? Is that the only way, direction we can go in? Or is there another option we have? Keep in mind, and Ananda Maima was still alive in 1982. Okay. So we can go back to the 80s and the 80s mindset, right? Let's go back to the 80s mindset and say, hey, now wait a minute. So computers, computers come out in, the late 70s or something, and they start taking off in the 80s, right? But we don't have the internet. We don't have, you know, we're still doing dot matrix printers, for, you know, and and we're saying, what are these things? And, you know, what can we do with them? And, like, well, it's interesting, you know, it's kind of amusing. I remember the graphics programs, it was fun, I played with them, it was, okay, whatever. Yeah, it's no big deal. And yet, you know, so we can go back and take a second look at this. Let's go back and take a second look at it. Knowing what we know now, having looked at the future, 2030. There's already a roadmap to 2030. We know how it's going to go. And we know the trends and everything. Why don't we go back instead of 2030? Instead of putting our mind in going into 2030 in our minds, let's go back to 1980. Let's go back to 1980. How about that for another idea? Let's go back to 1980, the mindset of 1980. I'm going to say, not so fast here, folks. Let's take a look at this other road, you know? It's a crossroads then, 1980. Let's take a look at this other road. Where does that road go? So we kind of, you know, ran down the road of technology for a while, and then we come back down, say, wait a minute. Let's see how this other road goes now. Let's take a few steps down that road. Now, also, I realized that these great teachers, they only disappear, they don't die. Because they were never born in the first place. They appeared. They appeared. Well, sure, they appear to go through the birth process and all that stuff like that, but actually, they're very aware that it's a mere appearance. And they appear because we wanted them to appear. And they disappear because we wanted them to disappear. But what appears and disappears can appear again. Okay? Keep this in mind. 1980, Ananda Mai Ma was not, the body was still here. Was still, the appearance was still here. Representing at that time, she was probably the preeminent representation of the spiritual path in the world at that time. Those in the know would say that, absolutely. And that's an appearance. Appearances don't have to disappear. Spiritual teacher doesn't have to disappear. She said she was coming unmanifested because basically intimated that the people, you know, it's time that disappearing because people had enough. Their heads were turning now towards technology. They wanted to take a look at this. Okay, let's say we take a look at it. We said we've taken a look at it. We go back to 1980 and say, hey, spiritual representation of spiritual path, going by the name of Sri Sri Ananda Mai Ma at that point in time. We've looked at this path of technology. Okay, can you show us this other path? Would you mind showing us this other path? We kind of neglected it because, you know, there's just, you know, the marketing and the everything was kind of said, what are these strange geeks coming in here with this stuff? What is that about? And the way that they were was so, well, hindsight will explain it, won't it? Okay, so we go back and we say, okay, can you show us this other path? Because we want to evaluate and compare the two. How about that? And if we put our minds back to 1980, the appearance is still there, you see. And there's no reason it has to disappear. If we're saying we want to be shown this other option, this is calling the appearance into play. It's bringing the appearance into play. I told you, as I said, such a one as this, who was an avatara, meaning she said she had never, ever come into the dream of existence, this universe, never had ever made the mistake of trying to scam God. Not she, but this spirit, this, you know, this consciousness, the one consciousness that was, this was representing this aspect that never, ever, and so there's no karma, did not appear because of any karma whatsoever, simply because of the world asked for it. These such ones like this, they can appear or disappear, appear, disappear, disappear, appear, disappear, depending on whether we want them to appear or not. This is how they function. This is how it functions. This is how it works. So it's not odd at all from that, because they're not, there's no karma. There's no dynamics going on with them whatsoever. None. None, 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 none. They know that this world is nothing but, you know, a dream, trying to trick God into thinking this is God's true creation. And God's true creation is only a dream. This is what we're trying to do here. So, if we go back to 1980, We don't even have to resurrect Anandamayi, for instance, to use an example. As again, this represents a spiritual path. This is, again, symbolized it in the strongest way at that time, without, as people in the know would say that for sure. So, wouldn't even have to be resurrected because had not died yet. And people said that at that age, when she would have been 80, like 1980, she'd been 84 years old. That they could look at her, and if they decided that they didn't really want her to leave, they wanted that spiritual path option to be presented to them, continued, that age would completely vanish, and they'd see her as completely ageless, not a trace of age on her whatsoever, not even the tiniest wrinkle, anything. You couldn't see a trace of age whatsoever. And they said, well, what's going on? Someone asked her about it. She said, well, that's, you know, you're seeing me that way because, you know, you're willing to see eternal life. You're willing to look at the option of eternal life. So this is how you're seeing me. This is how you're seeing me. And the others who are seeing me as aged is because they want me to appear to be mortal. All right. So it makes them feel comfortable. So that's how they're seeing me. As you play the instrument, so you see me. So you hear the tune. So you hear the tune. As you play the instrument, so you hear the tune. And then they said, well, which one are you really? He says, well, you know, really, eternal life is, you know, what we all are. So the apparent agedness and sickness and ultimately dying was merely the desire to see it that way on the part of the world. It didn't represent the reality of the situation, actually. Partly so, because, you know, this is the appearance, that's what they wanted to see, so that's what they saw. But it wasn't the only option there either. Wasn't the only option, actually. How do you know that people just didn't see an appearance of death? You know, the body appeared to die and be buried and all this kind of stuff. How do you know they just didn't decide to go down that road, but there was another road to take also, right? Maybe they were too interested in technology. They said, hey, you know, thanks, but we want to go down this other road for a while and check it out. But how would we know if we don't go back to 1980 that we can say, hey, I have a different idea now. How about if you stick around for a while? And you don't even have to give the appearance of age. We're going to drop that requirement for a while until hindsight kicks in. But right now, we're going to say, no, you don't need any appearance of age at all. We'll accept that, but like you to show us the option of spiritual path as an option to this path of technology, and ask that. So we're just brainstorming here, you know. We're brainstorming. We're in the vibe of brainstorming here. That's a pretty cool way of looking at it, isn't it? I'm not sure the UN's going to tell you to look at the world in this way, is it? Agenda 21, is that what they're telling us? That we have this option to do this? I don't think so. And now, Anandamayi contacted me in 1997, October 27th, what was that date? Oh, that's when the World Series, 111th World Series starts. Wow. It was October 27th, 1997, was when she contacted me. That's the date the 111th World Series starts in 2015. Wow. This is getting pretty great here. Pretty wowish. What is that? Is that noises?
I see someone.
Okay, pretty wowish. Pretty wowish, man. I'm looking down the road here. Who's coming? Got a flashlight. This is very wowish, isn't it? This is very wowish. How many days? What is today? 16th. 17, 18, 19, 20. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's 11 days. There's the 1-1 again. It's 11 days. 11 days from now is the 27th. It's 11 days to the 111th World Series, the anniversary of October 27th, 1997. Onto my mind, contacted me. Why did she contact me? Maybe she knew that 18 years later, or was it, it would be 19, or maybe it's 18 years later, I would be saying this. I'd have the capacity to say, let's go back to 1980. Wow. I told you, there's something going on here, isn't there? We don't quite understand, but we're starting to understand it, aren't we? And I did say, in a number of videos ago, that I did have this dream where Anandamayi showed up my dream as a young person without a trace of age on her whatsoever, and introduced herself and started. We just had a conversation, and it was quite extraordinary. And something about, I'm back. She said, I'm back. I'm back. But you might say, I never left, you know? I never really left, actually. Neither left nor did not leave. As you hear, play the instrument, so you hear the tune. This is sort of a spiritual musicianship here. Now this is good grist for the mill, isn't it? I mean, this is getting into a whole nother level of wowness. Okay, so I'm saying we can go back to 1980 mindset, let's say 1980. Before our heads were really turned in towards technology, and it was just kind of like a something faint on the horizon, something, you know, that's just, what's this, you know, and this is something to fool around with and spend some time with. Look where we are now. I've seen a kid walking down the street, and of course, he's like this with his smartphone. This is a young kid, young kid. Every now and then, he looks up, looks around, and goes back. It's like this. They go like this. Look around. This. Da, 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 da. Look around. This. This is how they walk now. That's how it is. Now, it's interesting. I have no interest in this future. As I look at the world, I have no interest in going forward down this path that we're going. No interest whatsoever. And I think, wow, well, that's terrible. I mean, this is the future that we have, so, you know, how am I going to fit in? But I say, whoa, not so fast. What do you mean? This is the future that we have. Maybe we had a crossroads. We have, you know, Yogi Berra said, when you meet a fork in the road, take it. So, maybe there was a fork in the road, and we got enticed down this technology road just to say what you know, what are they doing down that road? They seem to be, you know, strutting around like they're all this, you know. The tech people seem to think like the way you looked at you, like, you know, we got what you want. We know what you want, and we've got it. They had this attitude, and this attitude intrigued us. We got what you want. We know what you want. We've got it. Follow us. Come, go down this road, and you'll find out. Well, that may very well be they had what we want. They knew what we want, and we had it. However, do they know what we really want? And do they have what we really want? That is the question we need to have answered. And is there another road, the fork in the road that goes, that has what we, knows what we really want and has what we really want? There's a huge difference between what we want and what we really want. Super critical difference here. So why don't we go back and choose and take a look and say, okay, this path has what I want and this one has what I really want. And maybe my continuity fear pushed me down the path of what I want instead of what I really want. But now that I've been going down the path of what I want, and I say, you know what? I don't really want that. And working on my continuity fear, being go, wait a minute, let's go back to the fork in the road and say, can we get some help to look at what we really want? Can we get some help with that? Why not ask for that? Now, Nandamayama is one who definitely has the capacity to handle this type of request. She's the one that when the people decided they didn't want her, her body would collapse on the ground and start rotting like a rotting corpse. Bloated and rotting and stenching like, you know, the corpse that was just rotting in the street. And they were so shocked, completely out of their minds. They said, no, we want you. What are we want you. We really do want you. Okay, we'll pay attention. And poof, she came back to life. Not a trace of any of that honor whatsoever. This is recorded by, you know, professional people. Highly regarded, very intelligent Bengalis. Bengalis, of course, have a very long history, very intelligent people. Also, some of the best spiritual practitioners in the world. The history of spiritual, right spiritual practice, intense spiritual practice in Bengal is, you know, hardly second to none. I mean, you put the Tibetans there too, right? But, you know, the Bengalis, the greater Bengal, you go west, east, Bihar, you know, this larger area of Bengal is historically, you'd have to say, it's one of the heart centers of great spiritual practice in the history of this planet. That's why Nandamayama was born there. Her family that she was born into had a long, long history of intense spiritual practice with many, many saints coming out of that lineage. Many. This, you know, history doesn't record all the saints that have come out of Bengal back through the ages. There have been very many. In modern times, you can name them off, you know, Yogananda, you can Ramakrishna, Vivekananda, you know, and then you go back further and you can find some other great ones, lots of them, and it goes back and there's just it's just a absolute heart center of effective spiritual practice. So was not any, you know, wasn't just happenstance. It happened for reasons that they could handle the situation. But even they, you know, it was too much for them. Maybe they said, "Whoa, this is too much," and they weren't even sure if they could handle it. So she said, "Well, okay, you don't want me, then I'll leave." That's I only came here because you want me. If you don't want me, I'll leave. I don't have any ego. I got to come here or not come here. You know, it's all the same to me. It's all the same. And then they say, okay, we'll try a little harder here. Let's get down to business here now. Now, you know, but we're asking, show us this option, this other option, this fork in the road? Can you present this to us and help us evaluate what's this really about, the path of what we really want? So, you know, maybe a different dynamic, you know. And we say, you can just stay, you know, ageless, that's fine. So again, hurry, don't be late. Hurry, don't be late. Hurry, don't be late. Holy cow. October 27th. 11 days from now. Now, what day did in Back to the Future did it say the Cubs won the World Series? I think it was like October 24th, it said the Cubs won the World Series. October 24th, that's a resonant day too. Again, the 70th anniversary of the United Nations, formation of the United Nations, October 24th. There's also some other, there's something else with October 24th that's very profound. So not so fast, everybody. Not so fast. No, not so fast, UN. Not so fast, techies. Not so fast here. We've already made the request. We've made the request here. Request has been made. Not so fast. Hold your horses, everybody. Hold. Don't despair yet. And on the way back home, I promise you'll never be alone. It struck me like lightning. I tell you, the path of technology is not the way back home. It's a road to what we think we want. But it's not the road of what we really want. What we know we really want. See, we can this difference between what we think we want and what we know we really want. What we know we want is what we really want. What we think we want is distraction and delay. Is to double down on continuity fear and say, hey, we can scam God. And when we do, you know, we'll be the ones that created ourselves. We'll be the prime creator, create ourselves, and God will be our creation. You know, we'll reverse the direction of creation. Of course, that'll never happen. So, on the way back home is what we really want. I promise you, you'll never be alone. This is so intense, it's like I'm in an altered consciousness of some sort here. But you know, I'm fine, everything's great, but the intensity, I can't even measure it at this point. I mean, this is something that this is broaching new territory. We've gone to new territory here. You know, is not time flexible? Because what we're doing is just honoring time. Time only lasts for an instant. It's just an idea that only lasts for an instant. Has no actual any continuity to whatsoever. We're just honoring time. So we honored time by saying, what we're doing is went down this road of technology saying, oh, let's see if we want to honor time in this way. And then we look at it and now we're saying, no, 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 no. I don't think I want to spend that much time honoring time. I don't want to honor it that way. There's got to be a better way to honor time so it doesn't, you know, so it's the holy instant, as Jesus says. Let's see if there's a better way to honor time. So there's no reason why we cannot go back to 1980. Because again, all of what we're doing, what we call time, is actually our own honoring of time. It's all the now. It's all happening in the now. So we can go back to 1980, actually. In our mind, in our feeling of honoring time, we actually can't. All we're doing is this feeling of honoring time. We're just experiencing this feeling, all these props that we have. But really, everyone's just in the now. Everything's in the now. But if, as long as we're honoring time, there's nothing that says that we can't go back. We can't experience a different feeling, a different way of honoring time. Absolutely. Why not? There's no linear, true linear dynamic of time at all taking place. It's just the path of distraction. We think this is a way we want to honor time and to take a long time honoring time, or very, you know, this particular way. There's nothing that says we have to, once we've seen, well, no, I don't particularly want to do it that way. There's nothing that says we can't then go back to the fork in the road at all. Nothing that says that we can't, nothing at all stands in the way of that. And pick up the narrative there. Say, okay, you see how that works? This is quite something. Back to the Future may have been saying that in 2015 we'll understand time travel. And we may have just understood it, actually. Of course, we don't want to rob the Cubs of their World Series, do we? The Cubs are saying, can't you wait until the winners are World Series? I say, Cubs, you're not going to win it anyway. Kansas City's going to win it, so we're not, we don't have to wait for you to win the World Series, Cubbies. Kansas City's very tough. It's hard to put them away. Only Madison Bumgarner can put Kansas City away. That's the only person on earth that can do it. They're a pretty tough, resilient son of a guns. And the Kansas City team said, well, if it wasn't for Madison Bumgarner, we would have won. Yeah, well, if it wasn't for Michael Jordan, you know, the Chicago Bulls would have never won either. You know, the other teams would have won. You can't say, well, you know, if it weren't for that superstar, we would have won. Well, guess what? Superstars win championships. So, you know, stop crying. But got to give them credit. They're back. They're back knocking on the door again. So got to give them credit for that. Anyway, I don't think we can, you know, we're going to make you wait. We're going to go back in time and make you wait some. Of course, if you go back to 1980, you would not have been waiting so long, right? 35, knock 35 years off the 106. Whatever that is, 71 or something. So that wouldn't be such a bad wait, so you wouldn't feel so bad. Gas Cup fans, would you rather risk a 2015 World Series and lose it? And so it'd be still 106 and counting, or would you rather go back to 1980 and it'll be 71 years and counting? That's a good question for the Cub fans, right? Because what if you lose the World Series? Then it's like, wow, it's really horrible. It's still going on. But 71, you still got, you know, 35 years and 5 more years that you might win one. So maybe some of the Cub fans might even say, yeah, let's go back to 1980. I doubt many of them would, though. They said, we'll take the risk. Take the risk. But I'll tell you what, let's play it safe. You know, it's better to play it safe for us. You know, we're all Cub fans, so to speak, and the same principle applies. You say, you know what, let's go back and play it safe, because maybe there's a fork in the road, there's another, you know, that we'd rather take this other part of the fork, you know, in the road, at which point it doesn't really matter anymore. You see, that's a good gamble, isn't it? Because we already know this one is like, wow. It is what it is. Let's, you know, we didn't see the other one. That's not right, is it? I got a strong feeling there's another, road to take that we're going to really like. It'll be what we really want. Strong feeling. Now, I spend the day chewing out the tiger of Bengal, What do you do? What are you playing with me like this for, You made my life miserable since, for so little, since 1997 because you said you're coming back and you didn't come back, And you wasted all my time. What is this, I was just like, I don't want you to show up. I was just chewing. I said, hey, this is my opinion right now. I can change it. If you can change my opinion, then good, change it. I'll be happy if you can change it, but I'm just being honest. I said, let me just be honest. I'm not so thrilled about how this has taken out, my life has gone, and pretty upset about it. You said you were coming back. You didn't come back. And said, but if you can change my opinion, I'll change my opinion. I'm just being honest with you. And so suddenly, and tonight, is that she's coming back or we're going back? There's the question, right? Are both. Now, if this is the case, I might change my opinion. Not be so upset about it. I said, I didn't quite see how to do this. This is one teacher, for instance, you can get mad and they're not going to hold it against you at all. I don't feel worried about that. You can get really angry. In fact, she said, please get angry at me. Don't get angry. If you feel angry at someone else, direct your anger at me. That was one of her advices to everyone. If you're feeling furious at someone, don't be furious at them. Be furious with me. Pretty amazing advice. Funny, today I was lifting super heavy stuff all day. Got injured, sort of. Brutally heavy stuff. Well, we're dealing with some heavy stuff today. Not severely injured. I got some trouble, little trouble strike, and feel it. But it was just like all day, super heavy stuff. I was having to deal with really heavy stuff today. Big stuff, heavy stuff. Dealing with something real heavy right now, but I can handle it. I handle the heavy stuff today. Doesn't intimidate me. But we are in the realm of the heavy stuff right now, aren't we? Fine, great, thank you. We need to be. This is October. This is go time. This is press the button and start the car time. Now, this is what I can't explain. How could I explain this to anybody in the world? I keep trying to think. I need to explain to people there's something great going to happen, but how can you possibly explain this? They're not prepared to even think in this way. They think you're absolutely crazy. But I know I'm not. Absolutely know I'm not, which is, probably why I was part of this. She said, hey, can you do this? Can you do this for me? Can we do this to help out, help the world out? I know that you're going to be able to do this because you'll get it. You'll get it. You'll see it. I do see it. Doesn't bother me at all. There are a lot of sophisticated people in the world right now, among the young people about time travel and all sorts of stuff. Being that they're sort of astral in nature, a lot of them have some of that. So they might be able to see this too. It's possible. Some of them. I mean, yeah, a lot of young people are on this, committed to this path, and but committed some other path, the technology thing. But not necessarily all of them. Not necessarily. Certainly time travel, but this isn't really time travel. This is something a little different. A little different. It's a little different. Yeah, but they might be able to kind of say, this is interesting. I think the older generation might just say, it's crazy. What are you talking about? They can't understand it. Or they might say, wow, this is cool. Now we're getting hip. You see, now we're really getting hip. This is what we were looking for. This is what we were looking for. How to be really hip. So Little River Band, 1978. I think it charted in 70, came out, and then it was 79, it was still charting or something. But so it's right there, right near the 1980. Got us right into 1980 there, which is where we can put our consciousness now, our time honoring, put in 1980 mode again. Again, all we're doing is honoring time. We can honor time however we want to. We can go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. That's fine. What? It's just our own imagination of how we want to honor time, so we can shift back to 1980 easily. All honoring of time is, again, there's no time in it. It's just our imagination of honoring time. So there's no linearness at all to it, actually. We're to honor to our idea of time, we're pretending it's linear, okay? That's part of our honoring of it. But it's not linear really at all. It's just our imagination. We're the one spirits doing it, in his imagination. But there isn't any actual linearness to it, to this honoring of time at all. None. None, 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 none. So we can show up anywhere in this honoring of time. It's not really time travel at all. I'm hearing all these little noises, like, because it's getting so intense, it's totally dark outside, and it's like, wow, this is, but it's true. Is it not true? You see this? So in order to honor time, we're acting out this notion of linearness, but it's only an act. There's no actual dynamic of this whatsoever. We could appear a million years ago. We could appear a billion years in the future. We could be instantly right now. There's no dynamic whatsoever of real time, space, process, and form. None whatsoever. This is a dream of honoring time. Jesus said time was over and it only lasted for an instant. That's it. And we've just been honoring the memory of it like this. Now, what I heard from Nana my Ma was that she's going to help Jesus out. Well, this would be a way of helping out. Help present this other road that, after the fork in the road, and help us evaluate it. That would be a help. That would help Jesus out. And helping us play with time in this way, with seeing this honoring of time, bringing this theme up by going back to the 1980 when she was still alive, seemed to be alive here, you know, this does help Jesus out, because this is what Jesus is talking about. It's very helpful. Some have some clue what Jesus was really talking about. Most don't. But certainly, he said time lasted but an instant, because it was just an idea we had, but it had no, we couldn't experience it, actually, because it was trying to, there's no reality to it. We're perfectly free. So we had this idea of not being free. It only lasted for an instant. We call it time. But then he said, because it only lasts an instant, we wanted to honor our creativity. You know, we wanted to be creative about it, but we could only honor time. We couldn't experience time. We could honor it. But this is only our creativity imagining what time would be like, or imagining a way to honor it. And yet, again, there's no time involved, actual time involved with it at all. This is what Jesus is saying. He says, time is the greatest illusion of all. It's the one that you cling to most deeply. It's the most important one. It's very adamant about this. So knowing my mom, I said, would you like to see me again? If you go back to the 1980, I'll be there. I wasn't, see? And I'll help you recognize. So this opens up this whole issue, right? It helps us consider this. Because in our, at least in my lifetime, there's no question on my mom was the biggest spirit, the top spiritual, you know, whatever you want to call it, in the world, representing the spiritual path, spiritual practice, the spiritual path, absolutely the top. So it would be a good choice to make, absolutely. She's the one the other gurus went to, you know. The gurus knew. They knew, you know. They said, hey, we're going to go see her, you know. They said, let's, if there's any, you know, they felt a blessing. Say, oh, like they said, greatest blessing they've ever experienced in their life, like Yogananda, you know. He said, I've never seen anything like it. It's like effortlessly in the highest bliss all the time. He said, this is absolutely extraordinary. Just couldn't get over it. You know, just couldn't. And he had the highest regard, you know, and all the ones that were aware of it had the highest regard. This is just, you know, they realized this is some, you know, this is avatar, this is the pure presence, you know. Wow. So, you know, that's something worth, you know, going back to 1984, so to speak. You'd be a fool not to, you know. Even if you're a guru now, you'd be a fool not to. I'll tell you that. Again, there was no guru in the world at that time that wouldn't recognize her, you know, saying this is, perfection, spiritual perfection. And they loved to go see her. Just sit there, you know, just wow. I say, wow. They were wowed. So if you're like a teacher, spiritual teacher now, guru, who wouldn't want to go back to 1980 and see, and, you know, say, wait a minute, let's see, you know, if we had the opportunity like that, why not? Why not? It'd be crazy not to. Not really a guru, avatar, different, much more potency, I guarantee you that. Take any spiritual teacher in the world right now. The potency of an avatar way, 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 way more potent and tremendous, you know. You can't really measure it. Very rare that happens here in the world. So, but it did happen. You could say Ram Maharshi was another one. Absolutely. Very rare. Two of them in the same century. We might even go back to 1950 when Rana was still here. We could do that too, couldn't we, actually? Let's start with 1980, you know. At least I was alive then, so I mean, I know what it was like. I mean, you know, feel the vibe. I was at that point. I started A Course in Miracles in 1978, which is when the song Reminiscing came out. Same, wow, I probably was listening to that song. 1978, Course in Miracles. You see, we may not be in such bad shape after all, right? Tide's starting to turn here. I feel like a tidal shift has happened here. What's the day? 16th of October. Start of the second half of October. This is when the potency picks up. Second half of October. Always for me. It carries into November too sometimes. November 2nd to 13, Longchenpa introduced himself to me. November 2nd, I believe it was not November 2nd to 13. Almost 2 years ago. So it's this time frame, end of October, spilling over into early November, is some sort of very intense spiritual time. Positive, very, very helpful. Wow. We've had a tidal shift here, folks. I saw this truck, on a tow truck, that dropped it off at a repair place. Old truck. It's an old truck. I walked over and looked at it. The mechanic was over there looking at it. I said, wow. And someone else was looking at it and said, hey, this is when they really built them, huh? I actually talked to the tow truck driver. How'd that happen? And yeah, I did. And I said, holy cow, look at that truck you dropped off. That's really, he said, yeah. He said, I got one, 1968. I says, I got a Ford, 1968 Ford pickup truck. He says, let me tell you something. The way they built those bumpers and that body in that truck, he says, you hit something at 20 miles an hour, 20 miles an hour, you don't even feel it. It doesn't even cause any problem to the truck at all. 20 miles an hour. You hit something at 20 miles an hour, the whole car's totaled. Totaled. Don't even bother fixing it. It's totaled. Back then, you hit something at 20 miles an hour, nothing happens. Only problem back then was you hit another truck that's built the same, going at 60. You get two, you know, immovable objects hitting each other at 60 miles an hour. That was the problem. You go off the road and, you know, you don't want to hit a tree either, right? That's the problem. But if you hit other stuff, it's not a problem. Just when you hit a tree or another car, another truck, because both of them were built to not, you know, nothing happens. Just so the shock all went into the driver. That was the trouble. Yeah, you could plow through a wall with those trucks, you know, go through a brick wall. Absolutely, you could. I mean, those are work trucks. And he said, man, I love that truck. It still runs great. I said, yeah, I remember those days. I was alive then. I said, I remember those days. they build stuff to last. I said, you know what? If you're around stuff to last, you tend to think that you're going to last too. If you're around everything that's flimsy, you tend to think that you're flimsy too. And this is the feeling I have on this path right now. I have this feeling like we're flimsy, like I'm flimsy. I'm not going to last. Because nothing lasts here. It's insane. I mean, it's just, everything is so flimsy. And people are flimsy now. As I said with baseball players, they're so flimsy now, it's incredible. They can't, you know, they throw a couple pitches and they got a rotator cuff, you know. Need Tommy John surgery. My rotator cuff's blown out. My elbow's blown out. It's like a half of them, by the time they get to the major leagues, it's like half the pitchers already had Tommy John surgery. It's crazy. I mean, what was Tommy John surgery in 1978, wasn't it? It was maybe the first TJ surgery, something like that. Before then, there was no such thing. So they just didn't blow their arms out, pretty much. I mean, some did, but most of them didn't. A lot of them didn't, actually. Sandy Koufax did. Pitched too many innings, maybe, but no, they were tough. They were like the trucks back then. Everything was built to last. And it was a mentality. Said, I'm tough, I'm going to last. I'm going to last until I'm 90. I know some people, you know, older people pass away at 95. They were like functioning great up until the last day of their lives. Tough. Because everything back then was built to last. So you're surrounded, your whole environment, everything. You say, well, this thing's going to be here for hundreds of years. You know, no problem. So you think that you're tough. It's a mindset. Now everyone is like these pansies. You know, oh, wilt the sun. Oh, I'm just so flimsy. I'm just going to wilt, you know, and die. Because it's all, we're all, everything, we're surrounded by stuff that doesn't last at all. You go up to these super expensive cars and all this super cool front of their car and it looks like, wow, this is great. You touch it. It's all just super lightweight, cheap plastic, actually. Like, we used to make models out of this plastic when we were young. It's all plastic. Check it out. It's not metal. It's made to look like chrome. It's not metal. It's plastic to keep the light, cars light. And, of course, cars are made to blow apart when they hit anything, which does save the driver because the car, all the impact is taken up by everything collapsing in the car, you know, falling apart instead of doesn't transfer to the driver so much. Which is a good thing. It saves lives, yeah. But on the other hand, we do live in a culture where we all feel very flimsy, very ephemeral. Like, I keep, every day, I feel like, I don't know, can I go another day? I don't know, so I feel like so flimsy. I mean, back in the 60s, 70s, you wouldn't think that way. Nobody thought that way. I don't know if I can go on another day, you know. No, you didn't have that attitude. He says, I'm going to do great, you know, for a long, long time. I'm not going to slow down at all. I ain't slow down. What's that? Everybody just went full blast till they dropped, you know. Nobody had this feeling of I'm flimsy, I'm fragile, I'm, you know. No, it wasn't that way. It wasn't that way. This is crazy right now, this path of flimsiness. Totally flimsy. I'm fragile. I'm flimsy. Because this becomes our belief system, you know. This is where we're at now. I'm not going to get into that. I get agitated because it's true. It's true. It's true. Whatever you buy, if you look at it carefully, and oh, I know what it was. I bought these gloves with nitrile coating. They look really great. So these are awesome. I thought these were gonna last for a long time. Guess what? All the nitrile coating is gone. I started getting splinters in my hands all over, and they just put this very cheap, superficial look to it. It made it look like really sturdy. Like, wow, this is gonna last forever, and it just disintegrated and it's gone. It's just fake. Fake, you know, deception. Very deceptive. And I was telling everybody, I think these gloves are great. Look, everybody's wearing them. They said, yeah. And I looked up carefully. I said, holy cow. It was only a very thin coating of nitrile they put on it. perfect example of how flimsy something looks, substantial, and it's flimsy. And so you have these gloves, and it all wears out, and they're getting splintered. You say, whoa, how flimsy I am. It's all flimsy. I'm getting pain. It affects your mentality severely. That's what I love. If I had a car, I wanted like a car from the 60s. Give me something substantial. Now, the stuff these days is just, you know, meant to, I mean, the engineering is good on them, but I mean, they're not meant to last at all, actually. Even the work trucks today made of fiberglass, falling apart. Rivets popping off everywhere, whatever it is, rivet metal, cheap metal, pot metal with cheap rivets, and they're popping off. And everybody says, well, you just buy a new one. That's what people say to me. Everybody just buy a new one. Well, I say they're $45,000, you know. Oh, yeah, buy a new one. But this is the mentality, just buy a new one. How do you do that? Well, you got to, like, be working frantically, competing against everyone to try and get more money. Then, you know, you have to just dedicate your life to being a complete economic animal. And of course, then how can you focus on the spiritual path? You can't. So it's a terrible path. This path, horrible path, can't possibly be what we really want. And yet we think we're trapped. We say, whoa, not so fast. Not so fast. Maybe we're not trapped, actually. What was it in 1980? What was going on? 1979, 1980? Was that the last time the Dodgers won the World Series? Oh, no, that was 1988. Sorry. Oh, it was the 80s, wasn't it? Maybe if you're a Dodger fan, you might want to go back to the 80s, right? Yeah. They're still relevant back then. Well, that's a good thing. You know, all Dodger fans. I'm wearing Dodger blue, actually, right now. Dodger fans, let's go back to the 1980s. Come on. It was good times back then. Good times back then. You didn't have to worry about all this dysfunctionality that you have now. Of course, if you're a Giant fan, the late 80s were great. They went to the World Series 89. They had a very good team. Resurgence, but back the early 80s, pretty doggone lousy, actually. That was a real downer. We've already had our good times now, 2010, 12, 14, so we can say, let's go back to the 80s, that's okay. No problem. So, who was doing good in the 80s? I don't remember exactly. Probably the Yankees. The 70s were the Reds, Oakland A's in the early 70s, Big Red Machine, later 70s. Then who else did good? I don't know. Maybe the Yankees did really well. Yep. That was a good time. Let's go back to the 80s. Let's go back to 1980. Plan out a new route, you know, surf and safari. Let's plan out a route. Gonna take real soon. You know, you don't even have to talk about all the science fiction stuff the way that Jesus has shown me how to look at this. We're just honoring time. The honoring isn't the time itself, isn't time itself at all. If we just get this, this is a shift. I just got it. You know, it's like, whoa, wow. Not whoa, but wow, wow. And today I was thinking about sick people. I said, well, you could just be well right now if you want to. You say, I don't need to honor time in this way of sickness. Or I've done enough honoring of time with sickness. So I decided that's it, it's enough. Boom. You can be completely well right now. This is how I see everyone. And as far as people, I saw people that some people have, you know, developmental problems. Oh, I know what they call them, special needs people are challenged people, whatever. Okay, so what are they doing? They're honoring time by doing that. Continuity, fear, honoring time. Well, I say, you don't, okay, fine. You don't have to do that. I mean, maybe you've done it enough. That's enough. That's enough of that, honoring it that way. Let's go back and honor it some other ways. Let's go back and take a look at some options. We can find out what we really want. Maybe you can find what we really want. So there's nobody stuck, actually. Nobody's stuck in the slightest bit. It's all just a play of honoring time in our imagination, which we could change in a moment's note, an instant, any instant, any instant. We can tell the teacher we're surfing. Surfing USA. You'll see them surfing at Swami's. Haggerty's and Swami's. Pacific Palisades. San Onofrian Sunset. Waimea Bay. All over La Jolla. And no, I said Waimea Bay twice. I can't say that. Haggerty's and Swami's, Pacific Palisades, San Onofrian Sunset, at Waimea Bay, all over La Jolla, and down Doheny Way. Everybody's gone surfing, surfing USA. Bum, 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 bum. Actually, that's not the way it went. Goes all over La Jolla and Waimea Bay. That's how it really goes. Okay, Haggerty's and Swami's, Pacific Palisades, San Onofrian Sunset, Redondo Beach, LA, all over La Jolla, and Waimea Bay. There you go. Everybody's gone surfing, surfing USA, yeah. We'll all be planning out a route we're gonna take real soon. So this is the vibe, is bringing us back, bringing us back, bringing us back, bringing us back. Now, what if you weren't there? Well, we'll let hindsight answer that question too. We'll see how it goes. But remember, the vibe is now. So people can catch the vibe now. They can catch the 80s vibe right now. Even if you weren't alive then, you can catch the vibe. Now, how about that? You can catch the 60s vibe. The 80s vibe, quote unquote alive, meaning you weren't appearing here as part of your play of honoring time, but you were still honoring time in some way, somehow. And what we're doing is really looking at, the importance is to look at the other road, the other options, you see, that we can say, wait, maybe that's what we really want. And say, I'm not really interested in the technology, this road, Agenda 21, not really, Agenda 21st century, it doesn't really appeal to me, so I'm going to take a look at this other option now. This is the type of video where the wow is so intense, it just keeps going, which is great. This is what we want. Been a little flat in the recent videos, as you might have noticed. Not quite up to the wow is not quite up to the intensity of what we're used to. But that's fine, because we need to cool out a little bit, right? We're super intense, but now this is unprecedented intensity, wow intensity. There's nothing, this is way beyond what we've done before, actually. For me, I'm ready for it, so it's not a problem. How are we doing here? Oh, wow. We've gotten a pretty good video in, haven't we? Oh, it's almost 1 in the morning. No wonder why it's quiet. It's, yeah, virtually 1 in the morning right now on TV. It's great. I thought maybe my life would be wasted because I'm not succeeding. I'm failing. And then suddenly this idea comes up. I say, well, maybe I'm not failing. Maybe this is what I'm all about. To spearhead this. And say, yeah, I'm able to do this. Let's do it. That would change everything. Flip everything. Absolutely. Change the whole tide. Game changer here. It's good because there's the bottom of the ninth inning, 2 outs. I said, wow, it's looking pretty glam. But I said, no, you know, come on, we're not finished yet. Now this is a game changer. Too cool for words, right? Let's not even try to explain it. You know, let hindsight explain this one to us, right? Let hindsight, let's see, let's sleep on this one and just let hindsight kick in at some point, huh? We just did our part here and so, wow. Hurry, don't be late. And on the way back home, I promise you, you'll never be alone.